Well, good evening, everybody. All right, good job. Well, I had to get my picture off of there. That was scary. Listen, thank you so much for inviting me to be with you tonight, and it really is an honor to be with so many leaders, young and more senior, who are working at the state and local levels on an absolutely vitally important issue. Joyce and Paul, great job. I do intel gathering as a habit, so I went to the website and watched the videos and wonderful efforts, really. And I don't know if I could have put a Brussels sprout in my mouth at that age. Okay, you're probably wondering what an old soldier like me is why an old soldier like me is fired up about obesity policy, and I'll try and make that clear shortly. But I want you to know that I'm not alone. I'm here today representing Mission Readiness. That's a nonprofit organization comprised of over 550 now and climbing, or retired admirals and generals nationwide who have come to realize that childhood obesity is actually a national security issue. And I'll try and make that clear to you. It is seriously impacting our military's ability to recruit fit young men and women to meet the most important aspect of our nation's defense, the most important part of the national element of national power we call the military, which is the people in the military. And that's why Mission Readiness is fully engaged to fight and reduce childhood obesity. Now, as stated a year ago this month, I was in uniform, and I transitioned from military to civilian life after more than 35 years of service. And throughout my career, I've had the honor of serving with some of the finest men and women ever to wear our country's uniform from all the services, and I cannot say enough good about the current force. They're men like Brian Jackson and Jason Myers, and I'd like to tell you about two of them. Lieutenant Brian Jackson was 22 years old and barely 18 months out of West Point. He rode to the sound of the guns on a dusty street in western Iraq, jumped out of his vehicle to help recover a disabled vehicle under fire. Machine gun fire knocked him down, inflicting a severe thigh wound and rendering him unconscious for a moment. Coming to, he looked around and saw a senior non-commissioned officer badly wounded and unable to move. Reflexively, Lieutenant Jackson got up and ran to the big sergeant, hoisted his massive, motionless weight over his shoulder, and carried him to safety, getting wounded a second time while doing so. He then limped and sprinted back to the scene and evacuated a second soldier, dragging him with Herculean upper body strength and fast pumping, and by the way, bleeding, legs. All the while under withering fire. Weak from loss of blood, Brian was taken from the field, medevaced by helicopter to the aid station where the wounded were being lined up in a row for triage. Lieutenant Jackson said to the senior medical officer, "I'm okay, Doc. Look at the others first." And the medics did, not knowing how much blood he had already lost. Sometime later, a medic looked over at the now ashen and fading Brian Jackson, and they jumped into action on him and saved him. Thankfully, some months later, I witnessed Brian getting the second highest medal for valor in combat, the Distinguished Service Cross. Now, how about Jason Myers? Jason, while serving as Assistant Detachment Commander for Special Forces A-Team during combat operations in the Coast Province of Afghanistan, was on a joint ground vehicle patrol with members of the Afghan National Police, and they were ambushed by a large enemy force, approximately 75 to 100, who promptly disabled the lead vehicle, which exposed the entire column to an enemy kill zone. As the patrol was barraged by heavy volumes of enemy fire, an unarmored truck became disabled, further hindering the patrol's movement. And with complete disregard for his own personal safety, Jason ran forward to the disabled truck in front of the column and found two Afghan National Police officers taking cover behind the truck, one of them badly wounded. Jason dragged the wounded police some meters through intense enemy fire to a temporary safety area, ignoring multiple shrapnel wounds he sustained during the attack. He then dashed back to the disabled truck, turned the steering wheel, and pushed it into a ravine, clearing the way for the rest of the force. He ran in short sprints without cover for over 100 meters while engaging the enemy, who concentrated on him, allowing everyone else to come out from undercover and move their vehicles. He continued on foot, moving through the kill zone, providing supporting fire to the patrol, and relaying verbal communication to his commander. His heroism inspired his teammates to continue the fight and maneuver the patrol out of the kill zone. And here is the UT Chancellor, then Admiral McCraven, presenting the Distinguished Service Cross to Jason. Now, why do I tell you these stories? Well, to make a point. Look, before we left the shores of the United States of America from our forward base in Germany, I deployed from Germany as well, my soldiers and I received the best gear known to man. The best uniforms, the best socks, the best boots, the best eye protection before every deployment. I even got the best underwear. That's very nice underwear. But there's one thing no one could give us, and that was our physical fitness. You just don't get in line and pick up upper and lower body strength, a stable core, or get a rucksack full of cardiovascular endurance. We had to have it at the ready. It had to be a part of our lifestyle because of the nature of our jobs and our country's expectations of us. Our armed forces have to be ready to travel to some of the most difficult terrain on earth. By the way, I was talking at lunch about borders that don't exist, except maybe on a map. This is one of those borders. That's the Afghan-Pakistan border, which we patrol routinely. Flying over the Hindu Kush, walking over the Hindu Kush. And by the way, you may look like Central Florida. It's actually an orange grove in Iraq. Stifling heat. And by the way, sometimes we have to work through the most difficult weather on earth. That is 11 a.m. at my base in Iraq in the middle of a sandstorm. By the way, the light is shining over the door of the small gym I built in the plywood, out of plywood in Iraq. That you could work out in a sandstorm. It wasn't a problem. All right. And most importantly, depending on one another, operating in small groups, which is a hallmark of today's operations, small unit operations. And the health and fitness must support our soldiers applying their intellect in increasingly more technical jobs with much more complicated equipment. That might look like a row of trucks. Everything sticking out of the trucks is an antenna for some type of electromagnetic spectrum. The strange-looking square on the front, the end of a rod there, is actually lowered before we go on patrol, and it gives off a signal or heat, depending on what it is, and it sets off the improvised explosive device in front of us, not when we're driving by it. But it's increasingly more more technical. But you know what else that is lost on folks? Today's operations are wars or conflicts in and among the world's populations. And a fit, smart, well-fed, well-rested soldier must operate with character and discipline in and among the world's populations. Why is that? It's because our current enemies attach themselves to the world's population, so that is where we must go. We must look fit, be fit, have the diet and sleep discipline to make critical judgments as we interact with local leaders so we can bring security and stability to an area. You need the energy to confront human challenges and the difficult conditions daily without becoming cynical or dismissive to other human beings in need. This is actually soldiers in full combat gear rebuilding a school. Why would they be in full combat gear rebuilding a school? Because as they were rebuilding the school, they were shot at. And they did not stop rebuilding the school. And that's the result, and it engendered incredible goodwill and took a certain aspect of the population, a certain element of the population, away from the enemy in that area because we brought them a school. And I tell you what else we do out there is, we know we can't stay anywhere very long, so we have to train other security forces. And political conditions don't allow us to stay very long, so our fit soldiers find themselves leading the other security forces, armies and police, to meet a standard of fitness and build cohesion. Got to pause there. That smiling gentleman in the red beret in the middle is a Kurdish officer I got very close to. He was killed fighting ISIS in March. And building cohesion, sharing risk together, means that you can actually conduct operations together with discipline. There's only one American in that four-man stack. There are three other nationalities in it. And it also means you got to be ready to meet the you-know-it's-coming challenge from your other counterparts. He won. This is one of my favorites. The guy on the left is the American officer. It's Captain Nick Loudon, one of my best company commanders. The guy on the right is an Iraqi company commander. Also looks like a missing link somehow. But what happened was the two American company, the Iraqi company got together, and you know what happens is my commander's better than yours. Oh, really? The commander started doing a good-natured trash talking, and it comes to this. Notice the guy in the background removing the rock because it's going to get nasty. Anyway, Nick, fit, healthy, and trained level four combatives, which is like Brazilian jiu-jitsu, made short work of the large man with lots of hair. But seriously, you have to be ready to do this. This is called a pinnacle landing. The rear wheels of the large helicopter are the only thing touching the hillside. That is at 7,000 feet in Afghanistan. The soldiers getting on the back of the helicopter, all American soldiers who have been patrolling from 6 to 11,000 feet in the foothills of the Hindu Kush, which is where the bad guys were hiding and embedding themselves with populations. But what you may not know, that the untrained eye may not see the small helicopter. You'll see it, but you won't know about it. That small helicopter flying above it actually is above max allowable altitude. But the two soldiers in the little helicopter know they have to get above this dangerous operation to protect those who are loading that stationary helicopter. You've got to be ready at all times, ready at a high level of fitness, physically and mentally tough to deal with a multitude of conditions, and take care of your brothers and sisters like this picture shows. So that means when we're deployed, we actually do heavy physical fitness while we're deployed. It's so important to continue to train. We may do it in formal challenges or informal games. We always challenge ourselves individually. And even our military working dogs know it's important to exercise. I thought I'd get a bigger laugh out of that. Sorry. But here's what I'm most worried about. It's what I'm here to talk about tonight. I'm worried about the ability of our armed forces to continue to get quality young men and women like these being sworn in at Times Square in New York City. And that's because of this. According to the Department of Defense, 73% of all 17 to 24-year-olds in Texas, 73 in Texas, 71 up there is national, do not qualify to serve in the armed forces. And the key disqualifiers are these. They're unfit educationally, even among high school graduates. You got to have a high school diploma, believe it or not, to enter the armed forces. You have to have one. And believe it or not, 25% of those with high school diplomas can't pass the basic entrance exam for the armed forces. Unfit morally, and that's kind of tough, it's crime records or drug use. And unfit medically, and when we say unfit medically, overwhelmingly we mean they are too overweight, and I'm talking about body fat. And I realize I'm talking to the wrong group tonight about these facts. I know you are experts on how Americans have grown more overweight and obese, and that childhood obesity has tripled since 1980, but you may not have realized how directly this obesity epidemic is impacting the ability to sustain our military forces. These are the common conditions. Can you believe the number one medical disqualifier for military service is being too overweight. The number one reason you cannot join, you get turned away, is because of your body fat primarily. 31% of young Americans don't qualify because they're overweight. Serving their country is now out of reach for millions of young Americans who are otherwise qualified and may have dreamed of joining the armed forces out of pure patriotism or as a path to a better life or both. I'm worried, teammates. You know, back in the day, a drill sergeant could run a few extra pounds off an overweight soldier during basic training, but today that does not work. First, it's not just a few pounds. We see kids showing up at recruiting stations who are 100 pounds overweight. We see kids showing up, we see horrendous levels of body fat. It would take a healthy year or more just to get them down to the right weight to start training. And if we tried to go faster than that, we most certainly would cause injuries like stress fractures and joint damage. And while basic training can help build muscle, strengthening bones is not that easy, and you don't do it in 9 weeks. And it's costly. We found that overweight soldiers are 49% more likely to be injured. Overweight soldiers in the service are more than likely to be injured, almost by half, and that means they're not doing their job and they're choking up already limited health care services. And bottom line, we can't make up for a lifetime of poor nutrition in a few weeks of military training. And if a young person spends his or her childhood years drinking sodas instead of milk, their bone structure as an adult is going to reflect that fact. And the military is facing an unprecedented rise in injuries that stem in part from poor nutrition and lack of physical activity in adolescence, even among those who make it through their initial training. One startling fact is that about 80% of children ages 10 to 15 who are overweight will become obese by age 25. And that means the critical period for preventing obesity starts early in childhood. Now, you know, we've been here before. To win World War II, we had to enlist and train over 12 million people, mostly men. It was a period of far-reaching and near-term existential threat to our nation, so we didn't spend nearly as much time on their physical examinations of prospective recruits as we do today. Renowned World War II author Rick Atkinson describes a medical examination process in which the recruit had to meet very few requirements, including being at least 5 feet tall, weighing at least 105 pounds, and having all four limbs and at least 12 teeth. By the way, magnificent Texan, incredible World War II war hero, got turned down by the Marines. He was 5'9", 105 pounds. Fattened up to 110, and the Army took him. That was Audie Murphy. I'm glad the Marines turned him down. As the war went on, the Army was accused of no longer examining a recruit's eyes, but merely counting them. The scary part of that was that millions of young men examined, more than 40% couldn't meet even those minimal requirements. More than 40% couldn't meet the 12 teeth thing. And so on. I mean, it's amazing. And there was a reason. Most of them were born in the period of 1920 to 25. That meant they were school age when the Great Depression began and impacted families across the country and resulted in lack of proper nutrition and determined their physical health years later. There you go. I mean, we can learn this again. We won the war, of course, but the high physical rejection rate was a wake-up call for policymakers. They knew they understood the problem, and they looked for a single point of contact where they could get after it. The solution was crafted by senior military leaders and their counterparts from the U.S. Office of Education and the Department of Agriculture, and it was called the National School Lunch Program of 1946. That's right. School lunch program started to improve military readiness. It has grown over the years to where it is today, a $12 billion program that serves more than 32 million children every day, and is the source of more than half the food that many children get during their day. More than half. And it succeeded. A generation born in the 15 years or so after the war became the healthiest adults in history. Folks of my generation were taller, stronger, and faster, and generally healthier than our parents, at least for a while. Then we began to see changes in what Americans eat and how much they exercise. And we and our children got fatter and less fit. And now here we are almost 70 years later, And once again, childhood nutrition issues are causing a health crisis that directly threatens our ability to continue fielding a capable military force to defend the nation. And once again, one of the most effective places to attack the problem is the school cafeteria. Mission Readiness, the organization I'm a part of, was formed in 2009 just to help win passage of the Healthy and Hunger-Free Kids Act of 2010. That was bipartisan legislation, ladies and gentlemen. Imagine that. Focused on two things: updating the nutrition standards for school lunches and ridding our school buildings of junk food. In April 2010, we released a report called Too Fat to Fight, which brought to light how obesity is impacting recruitment. Another more current national report, Retreat is Not an Option, urges Congress not to renege on its commitment to improve the school nutrition environment. The report includes new state-by-state data from Department of Defense, really interesting stuff if you ever want to look at it, showing the number of young adults ineligible to join the military state-by-state. Here in Texas, the Armed Forces has relied on heavily since 9/11 for the willingness and the propensity to serve. Here, Texas provides more soldiers to the United States Army than any other state in the Union. And it remains high, by the way, but we have one of the worst obesity rates in the nation, which is one of the main reasons why 73% of young Texans are unable to qualify for military service. Only eight other states have worse obesity rates. Typical young person being turned away from military service today entered first grade in 2002. So I'm trying to give you perspective on how we have to go after this. The young people we will need in the military in 2028 entered first grade this month. We're making decisions right now that will decide what choices these young people will have in the future and what kinds of lives they'll be able to live. And I would offer tonight decisions that will determine the strength of our armed forces. To the greatest degree possible, we have to begin this fight at home. No, that's real deal. That's it. There's a debate right now in Washington over reauthorizing the Child Nutrition Act and whether the standard should be weakened or rolled back. But there's good news in Texas on this. Thanks to folks like you, we're among the states leading the fight against child obesity. And 100%, we have 100% schools meeting the updated nutritious standards. That's a wonderful thing. And each day, more than 3.3 million children across the state are being served healthier meals to include more fruits and vegetables. Thanks to y'all's efforts, whole grains, low-fat dairy, and lean protein. No one ever said getting kids to eat fresh fruits and vegetables will be quick, easy, or cheap. It's not that way at home. It's not that way in school. But schools are finding it a way. Now, look, this is tough. The business end of this doesn't support purchasing good food. It is frequently more expensive, and good food is less profitable for manufacturers and suppliers. But those should be some of the last reasons Congress should back away from new standards, and in my mind, the survival of my nation trumps those concerns. In addition to healthy school meals, Mission Readiness also advocated for quality physical education schools. I live right across the street from Fulmore Middle School off of South Congress, and actually check them out for physical training. I might be retired, but I'm not out of it. They actually do a wonderful job. They're doing really creative things to introduce children to fun exercise, get them going. So that's working there. I'm proud of them. But quality, you know, strong PE, quality pre-K, and safer and better biking and walking infrastructure across the country, anything we can do to link diet, exercise, and healthy sleep habits would be huge. And I go back to the need that fitness, the desire to be active and healthy, has to be a lifestyle choice. It must be in our culture, and we have to care enough to act. And I want to thank you all for caring enough to be a part of the solution. I want to thank you so much for, that's two-star general reading to a kindergarten class. It's probably the best part of his day, I guarantee it. Combating childhood obesity is an uphill battle. And the 550-plus fellow retired admirals and generals on Mission Readiness look forward to working with you all so that our young people will grow up healthy and successful in whatever path of life they choose, military or not. But on a personal note, I'd like to leave you with a final thought. The military is, to a great degree, a closed society. The experiences we have had over the last 12 years are incomparable, mostly because we've been an all-volunteer force. There's no draftees. Everybody there wants to be there. This is the longest period of conflict our nation has ever endured with a force totally made up of volunteers than any other time in our history. We went past the revolution. History has shown us human nature creates places in the world where good men and women must make a payment in blood for their own or for others' freedoms. And I, for one, do not expect human nature to change. No matter how small the military gets, no matter how little money there might be left to train, there are more payments in blood in our collective future. And I am motivated to continue this fight against childhood obesity because I want to make sure this picture does not become something like this. But ladies and gentlemen, it could. We Americans tend to ignore certain conditions until they achieve crisis proportion. We simply do not like to be told what to do. We're Americans. That's a good thing. But sometimes we must self-correct. But there are other reasons why I'm motivated. Because for 35 years, I've been rubbing shoulders with those soldiers who went before me, sacrificed much and passed the responsibility for the defense of freedom to me. Like private kitchens here, decorated, multiple decorations, World War II. He fought from North Africa to Berchtesgaden with the 3rd Infantry Division. 3 Purple Hearts. Anyway, he's wearing private first class. I said, kitchen. How could a guy who fought from North Africa to Berchtesgaden only make private first class? He said, I was a master sergeant twice. I got busted twice. He did not like authority. But he cries, still cries, every time the national anthem is played. Or the Korean War vet who fought to stand up out of his wheelchair at one of my ceremonies when the U.S. flag came into view. These people knew the cost of war, the cost of being unready, the word sacrifice, action, and they knew exactly what sacrifice means. I knew I had to live a life worthy of their sacrifice, the sacrifice of those who came before me, and of course, worthy of those serving today. I was getting ready to depart for the airfield for a deployment one time when I was commander of a large unit. And it was that moment where families are gathering around to say goodbye before we get on the bus and it takes us into the military airfield. And I'm standing there with my soldiers and their families, and one of the wives made a beeline for me and hugged my neck very tightly. And she said into my ear, it was part growl, part whisper, but a completely understood order from her, bring my husband back alive. And that's why we do this. It's about readiness. A fit military force has a greater chance of survival and returning to those most important people on earth. And those are the reasons why I do this, why this is so important to all of us as a nation, and why I'm so grateful to meet our champions here tonight and all of those of you who are making a difference. Thank you very much for your patience with me.